Immediately they came upon the city of Mara. Amen. Now the Bible says that when they were in Mara, they could not drink of the water of Mara because the water was bitter. Amen. Now the Bible says they complained to Moses that we cannot drink this water because this water is bitter. Amen. Now, after that, the Bible says Moses took a tree, then put it into the water, and the water was turned sweet. Then they started drinking. Amen. But during this process, the Bible says after they left Mara, they went to the city called Elim. And the Bible says in Elim, there were 12 streams of water. And the Bible says that is where they established their tents. They pitched their tents. Amen. Now, after a deliberation I had with some believers, I began to ask, but why didn't they pitch their tents in Mara when the waters were turned? Rather, they decided to pitch their tents in the land of Elim. And it came because, remember, these people were people who journeyed a journey passing through waters. But even though they were passing from water to water, they still were thirsty. I don't know why they did not drink of the water of the Red Sea. Now it is because it was the Red Sea. But when they came to Mara, they did not pitch their tents in Mara. Even after the water was turned to be sweet, they did not say, because the water has been turned and is now drinkable, then we can pitch our tents. But rather they said, let us go to a city that has got 12 streams, because there in Israel there are 12 tribes. So we need something that is going to be conducive to accommodate the entirety of our group. So we cannot, even though the situation has been turned and is a situation that we can enjoy and partake of it, but because there are streams that are 12 in the land of Elim, then that's where we can pitch our tents. Allow me to submit it tonight that sometimes, because some situations can be conducive for us to partake of, that does not mean we must stay there. I'm reminded of my first sermon in FCF when I said, when the vision expands, one must relocate. Because we need a place that is going to be able to accommodate the expansion of the vision. So amanza guguliwa waka awaseko kaka in Mara. Even though the land is still called Mara, in actual fact, that land never changed to become another land. Mhlawumbe it was sweetened water. It still remained Mara. To show that lamanza gaphinda buyele into being bitter. But there in Elim, there are 12 streams. And one thing a stream is that a stream boom tall. Imvela piawo ayaziwe. It's water that has sprout from underneath. That means there is abundance of provision for water. Singahlala ngamanda la sweet awasemara. But the water is not going to sustain us. We need a land that is going to have streams. I'm reminded of the book of Genesis that the Bible says, even before God instituted the coming of the rain, there were four streams that sustained the Garden of Eden. That though there were no, my God, though there was no rain to sustain all the vegetation, but the streams that came from underneath. And I remember John saying, for I saw in the temple that there was a river that flowed from the temple. Change and transform to give us exactly what we need temporarily. But we must grow and mature and get to a state where we are not only focused on the not by the lakes or the rivers, but by streams. He gives fruit at the right time. The matter of seasons must run out in your life when you are in a place unsustainable. When people need prophecy, they must come to you. When they need healing, they must come to you. Because you are planted by streams that sustain your life. You are ever flowing. The thief comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy, but I've come to give you life and have it abundantly. Have life with no limits, life with no boundaries. When they need counseling, they must consult you. Because your streams are ever flowing. Sing about you, Omlabot. We are people of moving waters. One thing I know about water. When water comes, no matter how strong the building is, the water finds a way to push it. Sustainable kings. Ever flowing, ever flowing, ever flowing. I feel led to dwell on this thing. Jesus says, umoya, by the way, English, upepezela akuthanda kho. So are those that are led from the Spirit. Because you do not trace where they come from and where they are going. That means there is nothing that can measure. There is nothing that can limit those that are led by the Spirit. In other words, when we come to a life of being established in the Spirit of God, our lives have got no trace of where we come from. They say you come from an evangelical move. They see you moving apostolic. You come from an apostolic background. They see you evangelistic because your matter is ever flowing. According to Isaiah, you are a person moving. You are able to detect the rhythm of God's heartbeat. What God is doing in this season, you are able to download it and utter it in words understandable to men. Life in the Spirit. Life in the Spirit is that confusing life that goes to pray for rain while carrying an umbrella. Life of the Spirit is that life that is faithful. Not faithful in terms of uthembek, but faithful in terms of ugcwelelukhona. Your life is filtrated by faith. Whatever words you utter, God honors because you speak them positionally. I'm sorry that I'm not going to get a verse, but let us know about that. That is what is tailor made for Christians. If you think I'm lying, go to the book of Acts. The Bible says the apostle Philip, God had a eunuch who was by the sea. He was still busy serving the apostles. The Bible says the Spirit of the Lord came upon him. At the blink of an eye, he disappeared and appeared in front of the eyes of the eunuch. And the eunuch thought the man was an angel. He was a mere man like you, having flesh and blood, breathing the very same oxygen that we have. But what was different from him? The Bible says he was a spirit-filled man. In other words, whatever about his life was dependent on the Spirit. Whatever defined his identity was nothing but the Spirit. For those who are the sons of God are led by the Spirit. We need to grow from fighting on elementary things of the gospel. We need to come to a point of devouring mature food. But when we gather, we no longer argue about our time. We no longer argue about all these things, the foundational things. We get to the depth of peace. The Christ walking and living the spirit. When we move limitless, while you are sleeping, my brother, the spirit comes upon you. You know, out of body experiences are your daily bread. God takes you to Asia. You go and preach on a person. In a dream, the person is saying, you come back to your body. Things that are our own. Where? We just make contact with our clothes. Their lives are transformed forever. Just like the apostles. Oh, Petros, no, Peter, they did not eat anything. They never ate petrol and drank whatever. They were living like you and I. Amen. But one thing that distinguished them from the most was that they were spirit-led. Searches the deep things of God. If you want the mind of God in this season, stay and reside in the spirit. That is where all breakthroughs. Did you become a governmental consultant, Mr. Sagons? When the government is looking for advice, you stand and say, come, here I am, just like Joseph. You interpret things that can never be solved by legislation. Because we live in the spirit. Your life is influenced. God is taking form. Abide on Him. When we move in the spirit, how I pray is in a pellet foute. But this thing has the substance and the backing of the spirit. When we utter things happen, we all want to do more than what Jesus did. Life in the spirit. It begins with you. Begins with you. Deciding consciously. Lord, I want to move. I want to swim in the.
Hallelujah.
Ezekiel was directed to God. He says, I took 1,000 miles and the waters were at the ankle level. I went 1,000 miles deeper. They went to the knees. And 1,000 miles, they went to the waist. I went 1,000 again and they came on my chest. He then says, then I went further and I was in the overflow. In other words, though I tried to control what I'm doing, I could no longer. The force of the waters was just pushing me. The force of the waters was influencing me. That's why I was able to say, when God asked me, can these bones come back to life? I said, Lord, only you know. And then I was able to hear instantly God saying, prophesy, and I prophesied, and the bones began to shatter and come back to life.
Amen.
Because life in the spirit is being able to detect what God is saying in that time, in that season. What God is saying about your life, what God is saying about your family, what God is saying about your academics, what God is saying, your entire life is immersed in the spirit. How I pray.
Oh, yes, Lord.
That we become people of the spirit.
Oh, yes, Lord.
I'm sorry to be addressing these things without logic. But even the worship team, gone are the days when we have new songs today. So I'm not saying it's the wrong thing. But we need to come to a level when you are alone. A melody from heaven comes. It shakes you.
My God.
You are no longer limited to what us who. You come with a new song. The song of the season. Preachers no longer need to write notes as I did. But I need to say, Lord, when they come to the pulpit, they say, Lord, I've got nothing to say to your people, but you are utter to me. Are you telling us how to turn this microphone to impress us? But a prayer that will be sincere and God moves.
Amen.
But all this thing lies in faith. All this thing lies in faith. If you don't believe you can live there, you won't. It's a matter of believing that the mind of Christ that was in Him is the very same mind that is in me. What is the mind of Christ? It is the mind that, even though the cross was placed before Him, but He perceived the glory. What made Him endure was the mind that told Him,
yes, Lord.
Help us, Lord, to live in the Spirit. Don't worry, I'm not preaching to you alone. I'm preaching to myself every time I stand. As a matter of fact, this is a statement. Whenever I stand to preach, I'm preaching to myself. We need to grow, Pastor. We need to mature. Where prayer no longer becomes a place of you are no longer pushed and forced to pray. But prayer becomes a place of delight. You move from having prayer as something of discipline. My pastor usually says prayer has three different stages. It's a place of discipline where we say 2 hours, I won't pray less than 2 hours. That's disciplining your body. It's biblical. To Paul, I discipline my body in every means. But you grow from disciplining your body after a habitual desire has been evolved within you. You come to a level where prayer becomes a desire. If you do not pray, but you feel a desire to pray.
Amen.
You don't feel the burden to pray, but something within you yearns to speak to the Father. Something within you pushes. Prayer becomes into inclination to delight to talk to your Father. As you delight to meet your friend after recess, that's the very same thing that should be projected when you're living in God.
Amen.
Desire to be with Him.
Amen.
That's not the end. You grow from desire. You come to a place of delight. Where in your shower you just go, you are holy.
Yes,
and
Lord.
The heavens come.
Amen.
Your roommates become confused. What are these melodies from your heart? Can you are sitting with angels?
Amen.
Because prayer is a place where you sit. You sleep on your back and the heavens are open. You don't need to build yourself up in tongues for you to feel this thing. It comes because you are the people of the waters. We move as the Spirit leads.
Oh, yes, Lord.
Because one thing about your one is that He breaks human logic. All these defined systems that we need for God to move, we have to do A, B, and C. All these defined systems, when the Spirit comes, He breaks them and He does a new thing. How I pray in this season, we may be able to sense and move and live in what God is saying, living in the Rhema word.
Amen.
Able to detect what is God saying now.
Amen.
Paul says here, I'm closing, about 5 minutes. Paul says, oh my dear children, of whom I am in labor, until Christ is formed in you. One thing that's amazing about this is that Paul never used the words my children in anything he wrote. He always said, beloved, my brothers and stuff. We've got no time to get into the history of why he said that. But Paul's desire was that Christ be formed within the believers. In other words, the person of Christ lives in people. A mere man like you and I live in the full existence and functioning of God within them. And every attribute that is of Christ is found in man. So when Paul speaks about Christ being formed in a believer's life,
Yeah.
not here. The finished work of Calvary was done on your behalf. Paul says, I yearn, like I am in labor pains, that Christ be formed in you. In other words, the persona, the attributes, the entirety of what is of Christ is found in you. Whatever you would have said or you would have uttered in a certain situation is what you are. The divinity of Christ be in you. In its fullness. Let me end there. Through your life. The way Christ would have done, the way Christ would have thought, is what is projected and shown by your life.
Amen.
Coming to divinity. The immortality of Christ lives within you. Paul says in Colossians, now this is the hope, now this is the mystery.